Hi everyone. Yeah, I got the postman slot and the challenge is accepted. I have a Spider-Man slide coming up, so those who are sleeping will still get up. And it's a 15-minute talk. Who am I? I'm Raghavendra Talur. As he just said, I work for Red Hat. I have been working with Gluster. It's a software-defined storage for about 4 years now. And for the past few months, I've been working on containerizing Gluster and also making Gluster the de facto storage system for containers. And the talk today is about this. Basically, how not to do this. So when I heard the term persistent storage for the first time, I was curious and a little confused. Isn't storage always persistent? Why do we need to call it as persistent storage? So in container world, in the container platform, that's required. And the reason is, if your pods are your containers, then your nodes from Kubernetes or any other container platform are different ships. When you port a container from one ship to another, you have to ensure that the storage is also ported. Otherwise, you risk putting it down into the water. So we'll tell you how not to do this and what's our solution for it. Why is this an interesting problem to solve? So a survey which was conducted recently, we asked admins what's the most challenging aspect of setting up a container platform. And 25% of them said that it's persistent storage. We don't know how to get this right in container platforms. Another survey said that it's the complexity of setting up persistent storage which is most compared to even the scale or the cost problems of persistent storage. The same survey, we also asked, okay, so it's a problem, and so what are you trying to do? How are you trying to solve this problem of persistent storage? They said, okay, we considered everything, but I think we will go with the existing SAN or the NAS appliances we have. At least a 33% said we will try to use some software-defined storage, but a very low number, only 18% replied saying that we will try to have something which is hyper-converged with my container platform, something which is embedded into my container platform. And this is a very low number in my opinion. A good system is a system which is complete by itself. It should be coherent. And if you're trying to glue in two different systems to get a solution, it's probably not the right way to do it. And that's what this solution will try to solve. For those of you, okay. So persistent storage, as you looked at the slides, why is it different? Why is storage that much of a problem when it comes to container platform? Because storage is not a commodity like CPU cycles and memory are. So in Kubernetes, it's already solved. You will get the same number of CPU cycles and memory when the pods move from one container, one node to another. That's not the case with storage. And because it is not yet an integral part of container platform, you also have the problem that it requires some extra management effort, sometimes even extra storage expertise. What happens in this case is that you have two admins. One admin who is maintaining the Kubernetes cluster or the container platform cluster, and the other admin who is trying to do only the storage part there. And as we saw in the previous slide already, most of the times storage is kept external to the platform. This is again a problem. So before I go into the solution, I'll have to recap through how you do persistent storage in Kubernetes. It's a very simple thing. When you want persistent storage for your application, you claim for it. It's called persistent volume claim. You write a spec which says, I need this much of space with this access mode, and it should come from this storage class. This is a request that you send to Kubernetes. It will satisfy the request based on the inputs that you gave. Once the request is satisfied, it's called that the PV is now bound. Once the PV is bound, you use it in your application pod. This is a sample application pod spec for Nginx. All we need to do here is mention what is the name of the PV claim that you want to be bound with this and where you want it to be mounted. And that's it. So this is how persistent volume works in Kubernetes. It's similar for other container platforms too. Once you know how to use it, let us go into the solution. Let's take example of a typical Kubernetes cluster that you have with three nodes. I have one master three node setup. Now, depending on whether it's a private setup or a public cloud setup, you will surely have some local disks on the nodes, or you might have some block instances on each of the nodes. So these green shapes, circles are the local disks or the EBS instances. Once you have this, you run a cluster pod on each one of them. You create a cluster out of it, and now the cluster will aggregate all the storage from all these nodes and will make it look like a single storage system. We also deploy a heketi pod here, which is an intelligent cluster volume manager that can be run on any of these nodes, and it is now made aware of the cluster. Lastly, we have a cluster provisioner. It comes with Kubernetes. It will be running on the master. So whenever a PV claim comes in, it is given to this provisioner. The provisioner knows how to talk to heketi pod and satisfy a PV claim. This is all you need to get things working. To use it, say you deploy an Nginx pod somewhere here. The Nginx pod will now talk to a Gluster volume plugin that knows how to talk to the cluster. And the data is available everywhere. If your Nginx pod moves from node 3 to node 1, it will get the same data there too. So this is the solution. Yeah, I know it looks a lot many pods with so many connections, and we have solved that too. So let's recap the components before I show you how to set up. So from Kubernetes side, we have a cluster provisioner, which knows how to satisfy a PV claim. We have a mount plugin, which knows how to provide that storage to an application pod. Gluster is the storage component. It is the manager for all your storage, which can integrate all the disks. Heketi is that orange pod that we saw, that's intelligent enough to translate a PV claim coming with a storage requirement into a cluster volume. And lastly, we have GK deploy. This is the tool which will simplify the process of setting this up. You don't need to run so many pods separately. All you need to do is run this tool with a proper input, and it will do all the setup. For those of you who are not aware of Gluster is a storage system. It is scalable, but this is a better definition in my opinion. So what we do is we aggregate local file systems from where? From multiple machines. We aggregate them. We call that cluster of machine as cluster storage pool, and we let you aggregate in multiple configurations. If you have redundancy requirements, we satisfy that. If you have resource constraints, you don't want to waste too much of storage space, then you can use erasure coding. So the configurations are many, and you can use it as per your requirement. There are some added features like snapshot. You can take snapshot of a volume. You can also use encryption on the wire, and we have bitrot and quota and stuff. And it's not only our cluster native protocol which you can use to access it. The well-known other protocols like NFS and SMB are supported. We also support Swift. Okay, so now let us move to how to set up. As I told you, it's a single command to run. You just give an input saying how your cluster is made up of the container platform. And let's start. This setup is similar to what I showed in the diagram there, single master, three node setup. There are no pods running as of now, and this is the input file. The input file is very simple. You just need to tell me which are your Kubernetes nodes, what are the IPs and the host names, and what devices on those nodes are free to be used by cluster. So in this sample file, I have three nodes, each of them having three disk devices. We also have a concept of zone. This is similar to the failure domain of Amazon. So if you have VMs running in East Zone and West Zone, then you can specify that here, and that will be taken as an input when we create a volume. We will try to make sure that the replicas are spread over different zones so that you have better availability. You can reuse the same concept for private clouds by mapping your zones to the power racks that you have. Okay. So that's the input file. You give that input file to this tool as input, and the option minus D is used to specify whether you want us to deploy cluster pods or not. If you have already deployed cluster through some other means, you can skip this part. You will have to open the right number of ports. It varies from each setup, so that you will have to do manually before you run this tool. Okay, so we now started deploying cluster pods. We labeled the right number of nodes, which meant which are meant to be running cluster. Cluster is here deployed as a daemon set because it is using disks. It cannot migrate from node to node. We have to make sure that the pods always start on the same node. Now, we told heketi what the devices are. Heketi is deployed. And it's now running. So you can see three cluster pods up and running. You can see one heketi pod up and running. The video was here played at 2x speed, but it's only 48 seconds. So the whole deployment happened in less than 2 minutes. And this is all you need to do to have a hyperconverged storage up and running in your Kubernetes cluster. That's it. So there is one small task that an admin has to do before he can ask the app developers to start using it, which is common to any other storage system in Kubernetes. You have to define a storage class. So the cluster is up and ready, heketi is up and ready. You have to now tell Kubernetes, this is my Kubernetes cluster, this is my cluster, and you have to connect them. As we saw, the connector is called provisioner. That's done using a storage class. We create a new storage class here. We name it as GlusterFS. We use the provisioner GlusterFS. We name it as MySC. And we say, okay, the provisioner needs to talk to heketi at this URL. The URL here is the only important thing that you need to make note of when you ran the previous tool. The tool would have given you a URL. You have to use this, create a storage class. That's it. So here the admin's work ends completely. Now he's free to relax. He or she is free to relax. No more work from the admin. You have to just let your app developers know what's the name of the storage class that you have created. From an app developer perspective, if he or she knows the concepts that I explained about PV claim and PV from Kubernetes, they will be able to use it. They need to know nothing about cluster here. So this is my PV claim. I name it as my PVC, and I refer back to the storage class that the admin has created by mentioning it here. I want to use it from my SC. I want 2 GB of space, and the access mode will be read-write many. As I told you, when a PV claim is satisfied, it is said to be bound. So now we have it bound here. To show you that it really used cluster in the backend, what we can do is we can use heketi CLI to list the volumes. So the volume had come up. This is a typical application pod that you have. Here, all you need to do is mention the PV claim that you used to create your volume, and you say where it should be mounted. Let us create the application pod and see if it really uses cluster in the backend. Okay, so the application pod, my app, is running now and it has no data in index.html because we gave it an empty volume from cluster. What we do is we write hello world into it and see if it shows up when we do a curl. There it is. And this still does not prove that it's coming from cluster. So let us do all the investigation what's required. So what we do is we now look into the mounts of this application pod. We see that fuse.clusterfs mount is here. So the clusterfs volume is found inside the application pod. We can also verify from the cluster pod here. We go into the cluster pod and look into one of the brick directories. A brick is a unit which makes up volumes. So we go into one of the bricks and see what it has in index.html. It has hello world. So this is how it works. I have not told you how we did this, but this is sufficient for an admin or a DevOps guy to set up a cluster hyperconverged with Kubernetes in less than a few hours with all the investigation you need to do. And it should be easy for any application developer to start using it. We have many more features coming up. We have file support already. This is what I showed you as a file support. We have block and object store coming in soon in the next release. We have more volume management features up. We have also reduced memory footprint because obviously if you are running storage pods on the same nodes where you are running application pods, you want as much memory free for the application pods. So we have done a lot of work here to reduce the memory footprint. Depending on how many bricks you are going to run or how many volumes you have created, you can get up to 5x benefit. There were suggestions for auto discovery of nodes because many of you might be using the auto scaling feature from AWS. So there are plans of using the node labels to automatically take in the nodes for cluster. And we are working with Kubernetes for the API for snapshot. Once that is ready, we will also have it in. Okay, that's all I had from the talk. Any questions? Yep. Yes. Yes.
So, do you have to do it manually or it's automatically fixed?
Okay. When a new node is added to Kubernetes, if an application pod runs there, it can always use cluster automatically. We don't need to do anything. Admin does not need to do anything. If you want storage from that new node to be used in the cluster, as of today, it's one single command that you need to run, heketi CLI add node, and you give the IP of the node. And it's inherited. With auto discovery, it will be made automatic. You can predefine what label we should be looking at. And based on that, we will automatically take in the node whenever it's joined. Daemon set, because cluster pods were running on all the three nodes here. So the cluster pod which was started on node 1, even when node 1 is rebooted, should not move over to node 2 and node 3.
So when node 4 comes up, the daemon set should start the pod here.
Yes, the daemon set need to be modified now to... So the daemon set uses labels to identify which nodes the daemon set should be running on. So all we need to do is, when node 4 is added, we have to label it appropriately. And Kubernetes does the rest of the work.
So if a node guys, comes, automatically labeled
guys,
the correct
one,
yes.
Then it should start the...
It will. We won't label it automatically. You have to tell us to label it or you have to label it yourself, yes. Once you do that, it will automatically start the pod there.
Yeah, hi. So I had a question. I have two questions, right? So one of them is regarding the performance impact of snapshots in relation to GlusterFS.
Okay.
Because I am coming from a background of ZFS, in which snapshots are like instant. Now, in this case, since it is spread across the network, what is the exact...
Gluster uses LVM snapshot in the backend to take a snapshot. The barrier is created for a very small amount of time, and we take a snapshot in time. It has no performance impact after the snapshot is taken. When the snapshot is taken, there will be a...
My point was like, for example, if I'm running it in a production environment,
yes,
and I have access to data,
yes,
I do not want any at any moment in time that my data is not accessible by my application.
User. Yes.
So what in terms of snapshot, what happens at that moment? Will I still have access to my data all
yes,
the time?
You will have.
Okay. The second question was regarding partition tolerance in case of ZFS. Sorry, in GlusterFS.
Yes.
Suppose one of my nodes goes out, crashed, EBS volume corrupted, whatever.
Yes.
What protects it?
You can always configure it in various ways, but the demo I did today with the default setting, what we do is we create in replica 3 mode and with a quorum of more than 50%. So what that means is if I have 3 node cluster, if one of the node goes down, you can still do read and write using the other two nodes. And
guys, just take this outside. Yeah.
Everyone.
Our next